choose this topic? Okay, cross-disciplinary collaboration. Instead of saying multidisciplinary, I'm saying cross-disciplinary. Just another word, more or less meaning the same thing. So let me get into the topic straight away. But before that, before I get into the meat of it, let me say that you all are already teachers, and some of the few might have research background, and might have done MPhil, PhD, or might be doing it at the moment, or might want to do it in your career. Or some may be just happy to be teachers. So let me explain the difference between a teacher and a researcher. As I see it, can we go to the next slide? Okay, next slide. Yeah. So first of all, I will make a distinction between a teacher and a researcher. Fundamentally, they have two different perspectives, two different goals. Okay. A teacher is a synthesizer. He is giving the broad perspective, is a generalist. And a researcher goes deep dives into a particular topic, a particular problem, and tries to unravel the mysteries of that phenomenon, that topic, and with his very definite specific approach. So one is a generalist, a teacher is a generalist, okay, and he has a very broad perspective, and he has to have it. A teacher who doesn't have a broad perspective will not become a good teacher. Okay, in fact, the what I would say is, a teacher, you know, later I mentioned Guru Shishya, because that is the way in our tradition we look at it, that a guru or a teacher is supposed to open the eyes of the student to the world. He is not pointing the student's eyes to only one thing in the world. He's opening it to see the whole world. Okay, so he's broadening his perspective. He's broadening his experience, the student's experience, student's perspective, and student's knowledge. He's opening up new doors and windows. Why don't you look at this? See this phenomenon, how interesting it is. See that, how interesting it is, and so on. So a teacher is in essence, is not pointing to only one direction and say, do only this. Okay. But a student does what the teacher, a specific thing which the teacher is teaching him. It could be a text, it could be an experiment, it could be a particular subject which he is studying, and he has to focus. He cannot disperse his attention, his effort, and all that. So a student's duty is to focus and intense, with great intensity, study that particular topic or a subject or a problem to as much depth as possible. A teacher points him to that, but at the same time broadens his perspective. And similarly, a researcher, when he is researching, he is very, very focused on that particular problem, that particular experiment, or that particular theoretical problem which is bothering him, to which he thinks he has a solution. He's trying all his techniques to solve that theoretical problem. Okay, and similarly, an experimentalist. He's doing everything possible. I mean, Dr. Prasad is a well-known experimentalist, so he can tell you more about it, how much he had to focus and how much effort he had to put on each particular experiment. Right? So, the teacher, in a sense, a teacher and a researcher are you can say, two opposite things. A teacher broadens your view, and a researcher focuses his view on a particular thing. And same thing, in a parallel thing, a guru broadens your perspective. Means he is supposed to guide you in, doesn't matter what question you have. Okay, you are free to ask him any question. What is called outside the syllabus. Okay, whatever bothers you in your personal life, in your in something else which fascinated you, and he's supposed to point you to greater knowledge in that. So either he knows it and he will give you the direction or answer, or he will point to a source from which you can get further knowledge in that subject. So again, these are complementary roles, complementary goals also. And you can say same thing is what happens with the horse rider and the horse, right? You are all familiar that horses have these blinkers, right? They put blinkers on horses' eyes. Why do they do that? Because a horse is supposed to go in the direction in which the rider is taking it, or rider wants it to go. If it keeps looking around everywhere, it will forget where it is supposed to go, because it doesn't really know where it is supposed to go. The rider directs it there. The rider of the horse directs it to where he knows the goal. Of course, he might change his goal somewhere in between and say, no, not in this direction, let's go in that direction. But he is in control. Okay. So, to make sure that the horse follows that, the blinkers are put so that it sees only in front and not on the sides. Okay. So, in a sense, a researcher or a student is like that horse. The teacher who knows where you are supposed to go will keep directing him. And now look at this, now turn right, now turn left, and so on and so forth. And only with this combination, proper combination of a rider who knows where he is going and who can see the whole view, 360 degree view, and the horse which can only see in front, that you'll finally achieve the aim. So both roles are very important. A horse on its own will not know where to go. Okay. And a person who can see 360 degrees but doesn't have a horse to reach there to any destination will not reach there. Okay, so it is a joint. That's why I'm calling these two goals as complementary. That is a goal of a generalist, a synthesizer, and that of an analyst or a person who focuses on the particular. One is focusing on the who has knowledge of the general, who will keep pointing to other things in the general while you are focused on the particular. In fact, in Indian philosophy, particularly what is called as Sankhya, they explain the entire creation process, Srishti, through two elements, that is Purusha and Prakriti. And Purusha is the consciousness. Purusha has nothing to do with men, by the way. Purusha is a principle, okay? And many times, English translators translate it as male principle and female principle. That is wrong. Purusha is consciousness, and Prakriti is action. Okay. Purusha, so a consciousness or a knowledge combined with action will lead to creation. That is a basic idea. I mean, there are many different layers to this. And in fact, many times in Indian philosophy, they talk about Purusha as the lame person who cannot walk. Pangu, they call it in Sanskrit. Okay. Purusha is a lame person. Prakriti is a blind person carrying the lame person on her shoulder. Okay. So together, the blind is being led by the seeing person, but who cannot walk himself, who cannot reach the destination. So the combination of action and analysis, the combination of action and theory, consciousness and matter, together will lead to Srishti. So it's a very profound philosophy in Sankhya, but something similar. Somebody who sees all and somebody who is focused in acting, in doing something. Okay. So that is another parallel. And the more mundane terminology, generalist and specialist. Okay, generalist writes textbooks. Generalist write a book covering the whole subject. Okay, and a specialist will write a monograph on one particular topic or one particular problem. Okay, so both these are complementary. Without that, the knowledge cannot grow. So, but at the same time, in a very rare cases and examples, we have combination of both in one single person. That's why we value them greatly. because they have done deep research into certain topics. At the same time, they have the generalized knowledge of the whole field and the surrounding fields. Okay, and all the complementary other fields of knowledge. So that combination is a goal that everybody wants to achieve. How much they will achieve by the end of their intellectual life depends on them. Okay, but that is the goal everybody wants to achieve, or everybody strives to achieve in some way. Various people might reach there through various routes. And in fact, it is this type of a thing which started during the French Revolution. Okay, that all knowledge can be put together. First of all, knowledge was not universal at that time. It was not democratized. It was just being taught in certain monasteries, certain small groups, you can say. And it was not available to general public. There was no universal education before French Revolution in the West, in Europe. So a group of thinkers, which included Rousseau, Diderot, Voltaire, and all that, they said that why can we not put all the knowledge together in one book? Let each one of us write on certain topics which we are well versed in, and let it all combine it together, and they called it encyclopedia. Okay, so then anybody who wants to know about anything will go to it and will try to, will hopefully get what he wants. Okay, so these people were called encyclopedists, because they believe that all knowledge can not only be put together, but it can also be democratically made available to everybody, not just a few elite in some few monasteries and few elite groups, because those times even general school education wasn't there. It is post French Revolution that general education came into being. Okay, so now let me go into let's go to the next thing, please. So let me go into a little bit about what is the whole human intellectual endeavor all about. So this is an area which is called epistemology. Epistemology means theory of knowledge, everything about knowledge. What is knowledge? How do we gain knowledge? And as well as how do we distribute knowledge? How do we transmit knowledge? As teachers, you are in the business of both of transmitting knowledge to the next generation. As researchers, you are in the business of creating knowledge or gaining new knowledge. Okay, so this is all, we are all in this whole knowledge creation, knowledge transmission, knowledge generation, business, if you want to call it business. Okay, that is a work. As intelligentsia, as intellectuals, we are involved in. How do we gain? What do you mean by know? I know something. What do you mean by I know something? These are some things. Each one of these questions are very deep, profound questions. And if you think over it, you'll reach your own ideas about it. And you can also read what other people have talked about it, but these are all very deep questions. So I will not even try to discuss any of these things. I'll just leave it with you. What do you mean by knowledge? What do you mean by knowing something? How do you know? What is the method you use to know something? Means how do you gain knowledge about something? How do you come to a conclusion that this is this? What is the evidence you use to conclude that? How does your mind work? How does your buddhi or intellect work, or viveka? In Indian philosophy, it is called sadasad viveka, means a discriminatory power. What is right, what is wrong, what is truth, what is false, all that type of thing, which is what you use as human beings, as scientists, as social scientists, as journalists, anywhere. Anybody who is looking for truth will try to sieve away what is the core truth and what is just a fluffy thing which is looks real, may not be real, and all that. Okay, so what is real? What is called grain from the chaff, right? What is the truth? So anybody in search of truth about anything, it it could be anything, a simple incident outside your house. What actually happened? Who caused it? What did it lead to? Okay, if you are a journalist, there is a small accident outside your house, or you are going on the road and you see it, right? And a journalist, if you want to report it as a news, then you'll have to find out what happened, who was involved in it, how it happened, right? And some people might go deeper and say why it happened. If a driver actually swerved and hit somebody else, why did that driver swerve? Was he drunk? Was he sleepless? Was he too tired? Or was he distracted by something? Was he talking on the phone while doing something and the other person shocked him with something? You know, so there, for any single incident, most mundane incident even will have so many aspects to it. So the more and more you go into it, more and more you'll try to recreate what actually happened. So this is for a happening. And and this could be a natural phenomena, it could be a social phenomenon, it could be just an incident, or it could be a scientific study of some particular object. Okay. So what is the methodology? What is the evidence? What is called pramana? In Indian philosophy, it is called pramana. In Western thing, we say evidence. Evidence-based science, we say. Evidence-based means it's not your opinion. You don't say, I think, I feel, you know, my view is, in my opinion, that is different. You can have your opinion, but that doesn't become acceptable to others unless there is evidence. So what do you call as evidence? What do you call as valid evidence? And what do you call as suspicious or invalid evidence? Means it's not enough. It is just, you know, I heard, you know, so and so told me this. That's not evidence. That may be a fact. It is a fact that you heard it through somebody else, but that doesn't become evidence that what you're saying, what you're reporting is true, right? So what do you call as evidence? What do you call, what would be valid and what is be invalid? In fact, the word pramanika, when we say pramanika in Indian languages, pramanika means what? We think it means honest. But actually, it means a person who is saying something based on certain evidence, certain pramana. Okay. Anyway, so this is the way we come to know about the external world. When we say we, I do not even mean great researcher. A one-year-old child, how does it come to know about the external world? How does it come to know about family members? How does it come to know what is a good thing, what is pleasurable, what is harmful? It is all through direct experience, as well as what somebody else is modifying his behavior or telling him to do or not to do, right? And then testing it out. You know, mother said, don't touch this. What if I touch this? What will happen if I touch this? So that is how the child learns, right? It just doesn't learn because mother said it, right? Mother said it is fine. And mother will get angry if I violate it is fine. But that doesn't stop the child from doing it in any case and finding out for itself whether it's, you know, something, you know, it wants to learn. So all human beings, human intellect, human mind wants, that is what is life. It is not dead. It is not a machine, right? The difference between a robo and a human being is that it's conscious, means it wants to try. It wants to learn. It wants to directly experience certain things. So, evidence, on what evidence we conclude something, right? One is direct experience, perception, okay, which is also called pratyaksha pramana, they say. Okay, I saw this, I did this experiment, and this is my data. Yeah, scientists will say, but that is basically pratyaksha pramana, okay. Similarly, but after you seen something, and then you see something somewhere else, something similar. Now, what is that similar? Oh, because I had seen it before and this looks something like that. So this is, you are correlating two experiences. You are correlating two perceptions. Okay. So there, you already have made an abstract understanding of what you saw first. Like maybe you saw smoke first. First time you saw the smoke. Right? And then, later, somewhere else you saw the smoke. First time you saw the smoke in your house, maybe. Then somebody else saw the smoke in the outside. Somebody was burning something. This smoke is the same as that smoke. There is something called an abstract smoke, or there's something called smokeness, which is common between these two smokes. See how the human brain grasps this, how the human brain generalizes a particular experience, a particular knowledge. This is amazing. This is really amazing. And then correlates. Oh, you know, that time I saw the smoke when a fire was lit in the house, when somebody lit a candle or a diya or whatever, and, you know, along with that came smoke. Now here, I'm seeing smoke. But does that mean there is fire here also? So this kind of where you do not see the fire, but you're still assuming that since there is smoke here, there must also be fire. That is correlation. You're correlating two different experiences. That is inference. Because there was smoke with fire earlier, now I'm seeing smoke, so there must be fire here also. So these are the various things which the mind uses, which human mind uses, both in the laboratory as well as in a one-year-old child, to come to conclusions. So one is direct experience, other is inference, correlating, using logic and so on. And then with this, then you make a model. Oh, this is what must be happening. Okay. Whatever it is, if you are as a political scientist, you may be seeing something. Okay, some phenomenon, some particular new party coming into being, or some movement, some, let us say, farmers are sitting. Now, why are farmers sitting there? What is going on? What are their demands? What is their experience? Oh, government is saying something. Okay, what is the government saying it? Why is it saying it? Why are farmers saying this? What is the differences? So on. But you, after investigating all this, you come to a model and say, oh, this seems to be happening here, right? This is what, so that is a model or a theory after correlating all these things. But then that is not the end, because phenomenon keep evolving. Your own experience keeps evolving. So you further observe. One observation is not enough. One observation, some data led to one model. But later you find something else, some new element coming in. Oh, ye bhi ho raha hai. So that means, you know, I need to modify my model. I need to modify my theory. And so on. So this is how knowledge advances about anything, or understanding advances at an individual level, and in a group collective level, the knowledge advances. Next, please. I'm sorry, early in the morning, I'm talking a lot of philosophy to you, but I think it will all fall into place sometime. And it's worth looking at things in a more generalized manner than specifically sociology, psychology, commerce, or management, or whatever, physics, chemistry, geology, etc. Okay, that we do all our life anyway when you study that. But now I'm just trying to broaden it to what is happening, how is in the business of knowledge itself. So what is the methodology? So what is the methodology we use in any subject to gain knowledge? First thing is objectification. Objectification means what? See, we are a mind. We are a mind in a body, right? As human beings. Now we are trying to understand something. That whatever we are trying to understand, it could be another human being or an inanimate object. It could be a plant, animal, whatever. Or, you know, somebody related to you, somebody close to you, whatever. Or even yourself. You want to study yourself. You are thinking about yourself. Your own feelings, your own behavior, you want to scrutinize. What does that mean? First of all, what you need is distancing yourself from that, making it an object of study. Okay? Object of study, that is called objectification. That means you separate it from you. That the subject is different, object is different. Subject here means not topic. Subject here means the person who is observing. Okay, that's why you say something is being subjective. Oh, I'm being subjective means it's what is within me. Object is something outside of me, my consciousness. Okay, so I'm studying the object. Similarly, observer and the observed. In science, you talk about observer and the observed. Okay, and first thing, one of the important things we see suddenly, even as children, and this is an amazing thing. Let me tell you that we talk about human technology, human civilization, how it grows and all that. So So we talk about fire, invention of the fire, discovery of the fire, creation of the fire as a major advancement, invention of the wheel as a major advancement, and so on and so forth. But if you ask me, the greatest invention human mind ever made, and to this day is mystifying, is language. Just imagine that just sound you are producing, that sound is conveying your understanding of a particular thing to another brain. So if you say pen, okay, pen is a sound, right? Later you can signify it with a picture or with a word, with some letters and all that. That's a different thing. But the shabda, the word which you utter, is just a sound. But it means pen to you, and it should mean pen to the other person who is hearing it also. Right? And he might have a different pen. You might have a fountain pen, he might have a ball pen, or a pen of a different brand. But he will also say, that is also pen, this is also pen. How is that? That means already your mind has generalized into something called penness. Okay? There's something called penness. There's something called chairness. So that all chairs, you'll still call them chairs, even though they look different, different colors, different design, and so on. So, how are you conveying abstractions? How are you conveying generalizations? How are you conveying universals? When you're pointing to a particular, you're pointing to a particular pen, but you're also conveying something universal about that pen. That anything which does this thing, which might look like this, is a pen, which might have different color, different make, and all that. Okay. So this brings us to the concept of classes. Okay. Classification. When you say classification, what? This is a tree. What is the meaning of that? This is a tree. Tree is a class of objects. You can say this is a banyan tree. Or this is a coconut tree. Okay. Even a coconut tree is a generalization. Because what you are seeing in front is one tree. It may be short, it may be tall. It might have many leaves, it may not have many leaves. It might be carrying fruit, it may not be carrying fruit. Okay. But from there to say there is something called a class called coconut trees, and this tree belongs to that class. Imagine that generalization. In fact, in Indian philosophy, it is called Samanya and Vishesha. Vishesha is a particular, Samanya is a universal, is a general. Okay. Now, I'm saying all these things because this is the way we come to the specific subjects. We come to specializations. We come to political science and sociology and psychology and physics and chemistry and biology, geology, etc. Is when we keep breaking things. Okay, when we keep breaking things into parts, when you keep looking at things from one angle, from one approach, we come to specialization. So it is very important to gain further knowledge. Specialization is very important. But if we get lost in that, and if there is nobody to tell us what is the general, what is the part a part of, what is the whole? What is this a part of? How many other parts are there? What is the relationship between the parts which make up the whole? So somebody has to give us that perspective. That is what a teacher does. In fact, one of the first questions you will find, because I am sure you yourself raised it also when you were students, is that, why are we studying this? Why are we studying this subject? Number one. Then when you are actually forced to study that subject, you say, but why are we studying this aspect of that subject? Why are you studying about Ashoka? Why are you studying about Mughals? Why are you studying about so-and-so? Means whatever is being taught, what is its place? The student is never told. Student just says, you mug this up. You learn this by heart. Or you learn to solve this sum. Why should you learn this way of solving the sums? Why should you learn trigonometry? Why should you learn calculus? Why should you learn geometry, Euclidean geometry? Nobody tells you. But all students ask that question at one time or the other, and finally they are beaten into saying, you better study this, otherwise you will not pass. If you don't pass, you will not get a job. You will become a lafanga, and so on and so forth. This is a normal thing that is done. But a good teacher tries to put into perspective to the students why they are studying something. Not just what is the content of what that lesson, but why should they study this lesson? Why should they know this? Why should they put an effort to know more about this? So your job is to open their eyes to the broader thing, to the in the broader scheme of things. You know, something is just a part of the whole, right? So if somebody is just only looking at the part, like somebody is turning a screw, right? If he is not aware, why he should turn the screw? This screw is part of some bigger machine. In that machine, the screw plays this role. That is how the machine can finally function. So if that person doesn't get that perspective at some time or the other in life, he will not even get interested in turning that screw. Why should he turn that screw? What is so big about it? Chalta hai. Ignore it. Or do it in whichever, haphazard manner you want. Because you don't know it's important. So to not only teach the part, but to teach about other parts of the subject, not only that particular lesson, but other lessons, put it in the perspective. And what is the relationship? Why should you study this in the first place? What will it lead to? So you can't just say, this will lead to, job. Okay, that is one, you can say one goal, one perspective. But why? Why people who know this are given jobs? That means they are doing something useful for society. That's why society is valuing them and giving them a job and salary. So you'll have to put it in the context of the economy. You have to put it in the context of the individual growth of knowledge. Because finally, all knowledge has to be in some way or the other useful to society. Only then the society will support generation of that knowledge or transmission of that knowledge, that is teaching. Right? So I'm not saying do it all the time, but at least sometimes spend some time in your lecture to put each lesson or each subject in its perspective. Why we are doing this? What is its importance? How it fits into the larger scheme? And so on. Okay? This is just I'm just trying to broaden. This is a... and similarly, like if there are individuals, like I would... If somebody is teaching science or somebody is teaching history or political science or whatever, don't just describe it in a chronological manner. Oh, these are Newton's laws and Newton, then this is experiment and this is it. Who is Newton? How did he find these laws? Why not tell a little bit about Newton's biography? Or how did he even come to discover these laws? That he is also some human being. He also went through ups and downs and finally found this thing. Right? And what impact it had. So talk about means you humanize these subjects. You humanize these individuals, these names, these events. Okay, make them living, not some dead thing. Try to do that. Okay. So when you only to study in a focused manner, you divide a subject into chapters, into different disciplines. Like in science, you say physics, chemistry, biology, geology, etc., astronomy, etc. Okay, that is just a division to assist you in studying your environment, right? Because your environment involves everything. If you take any simple thing, it involves everything in it. Physics, chemistry, biology, everything is involved in it. Similarly, if you look at what is surrounding society, any single thing you see, or even a human being, everything is involved in it. Only to study one aspect of it or another aspect of it in a focused manner, you divide it into different approaches, into different sciences, whether it is natural science or social science. Next slide, please. So broadly, we can say we can divide all this knowledge into two. Knowledge of the inner world and knowledge of the outer world. Inner and outer. Because human mind is involved in this. So what is inside of the human mind? Let me put it, or what appeals to what is mind? What we can call as subjective to that person. So keep that as the inner world. And what is outside of his mind, outside of his body, outside of his mind, outside of his consciousness, keep it as outer world. So broadly, we can talk about knowledge as divided into these two. So psychology, literature, art, music, dance, aesthetics, and what Indian philosophers called as Rasanubhava. Bharata wrote Natya Shastra. Abhinava Gupta, another great philosopher, Kashmiri philosopher, who wrote explained this further, wrote commentaries on it. So and there are many others who did, but these two are major names in the Indian aesthetics. Bharata and Bharata Muni, people call him, the one who wrote Natya Shastra, and then Abhinava Gupta. So they all talk about Rasanubhava. What is Rasa? How a particular emotion is created in you by seeing when you see something, when you hear something. Okay. So that is what it deals with. That is inner world. So art, music, dance, literature, when you read something, you know, it appeals to you, it touches you, or it horrifies you, or it disgusts you, whatever. All these rasas are invoked in you. Okay. This is all inner world. So all the, you can say, in some sense, what we call as humanity, okay, deal with the inner world. And then you have the outer world. The outer world can be many things. Outer world can be society, outer world can be economy, outer world can be political groups and political science, outer world can be stars and planets, outer world can be plants, animals, rocks. Okay. So all this, what we call social sciences and natural sciences, that come into, you can broadly say, that is part of the study of the outer world, knowledge of the outer world. This is again a broad division. Okay, let's go to the next one. Next slide, please. Okay, now what we see when we look at anything, whether it is inner or outer, when you see any phenomenon or any object, is that constantly it is changing. Everything is in motion, development, and change. Okay, this is what philosophers call as dialectics. Dialectics means there is change, motion, and development into everything. Nothing is static. So nothing is forever. Everything changes. In fact, this is what modern science also says. I'm emphasizing modern science, modern physics, because in classical physics, for example, in Newton's times, he thought certain things are absolute, certain things are forever. He thought time and space are forever. He thought stars are forever. They're still. He thought about ideal. There is a total what we call as inertness. Okay, no motion and motion. But today in modern science, we have found that there is no such thing. There is nothing which is static. Everything is changing. Everything is moving. Everything is relative in some sense from a certain perspective. Okay. And similarly, in fact, Upanishads say that. Upanishads, for example, in Ishavasya Upanishad, they talk about Jagatyam Jagat. In fact, the very word Jagat in Sanskrit means that which is changing. We use it to describe the world. What does that mean? The world is constantly changing. Jagatyam Jagat. Meaning of Jagat is that which is changing. In fact, Basavanna said that. He said, Thavarakke Alivuntu Jangamakke Alivilla. Means that which is static dies. It doesn't last. Jangamakya alivilla, that which is moving, that which is dynamic, that which is constantly changing, stays forever. That means what you see over a period of time is that which is changing. That which is static will, you know, soon fall. But now modern science will tell you nothing is static. No atom is static. No electron is static. Nothing is static. Even vacuum is not static, they say. Vacuum is full of so many things which are going on inside it. They talk about it. So anyway, so it, when it comes to social phenomena, it's the same thing. Like if you take, doesn't matter what, you may be studying the economy of a village. You may be studying, say, caste dynamics in a village or in a society. Nothing is static. You can take a picture, you can make a study, sociological study. You can make a political study. You can make a, you know, journalistic study and report. Nothing is static. It keeps changing. So this is one important thing you see. Then if something is changing, then how is it changing? What is its origin? Where did it start? What it has a beginning? It has certain growth area and then it has a death. Every phenomenon you see, both in nature and in society. Things come into being and go away. Then some new things come into being and they evolve and then they go away. So Nothing is static, number one, and everything has history. What it means is, history means what? It has an evolution, beginning, middle, and end. Okay, so these are the two things which we see in all phenomena, whether it is of the inner world or outer world, whether it is in natural science or social science. Let's go to the next. Okay, so then we have two approaches. Then we break a thing into pieces. That is called analysis. Analysis means breaking. Any phenomenon, any subject we take, break it into pieces. And study each piece in depth. You put it under your microscope, mental microscope or actual physical microscope. And study it in detail. That is analytical approach. And then you have to like put it all together. You'll have to put it together and say, okay, are these gelling? Are these different views gelling? How are they interacting among themselves? Right? Like if it is a slum. Now, how is the slum operating? What are the different elements of the slum? Who are the gundas in the slum? Who are the residents of the slum? Who are the slum lords who own the chawls in the slum? Who is one who occupied that land and built it up? What is the role of the state agencies there? What are the cops doing, police doing? What is the municipal authorities who come there to extract some bribe or the other, or to evict them and demolish them? What do they do? So that means you can study each of those things separately, and then together there is a phenomenon that is going on. Okay, so whether it is a social phenomenon or a natural phenomenon, one way is to break it into pieces and study in depth, and other is to synthesize it and study the whole. Now, both are required. Both are required to advance knowledge about anything. So when we say I'm studying sociology, political science, psychology, or physics, chemistry, mathematics, you are being analytical. You are breaking nature into these parts. But which is important for in-depth study, you need that. But if you get stuck in that in your own mind, or if the subject itself gets stuck in that, into finding more and more details of particular thing, and loses the perspective of the whole, then you'll see a crisis. So then somebody will come up and say, no, we are getting lost in the detail. Let's look at the big picture. Okay. So as teacher, constantly you'll be directing students towards the particular, and at the same time, you'll also try to give them the big picture. So both are required. Okay. Next, please. All this time I just talked about concepts and the theories, some concepts. You can think of those things. Now don't have much time left. Another 10, 15 minutes I'll spend in giving you some examples, and then we can discuss. You can ask questions and all that. We have time, another half an hour, right? So first example is, for example, Arthashastra. The name translation, Arthashastra means economics, right? But the Arthashastra written by Kautilya or Chanakya is not only economics. It has a whole thing about sociology, about morals, about ethics, about statecraft, political science, right? It has about diplomacy, it has about philosophy. So it is a multidisciplinary, cross-disciplinary product. So now English translations are available, Kannada translations are available. You should read that. Then you'll get an idea what an intellectual Kautilya was, if there was one intellectual who wrote it, because we don't know anything about Kautilya other than this book. In fact, even this book was lost. It was only discovered in the 20th century. One copy was found in Mysore. Okay, somewhere in Mysore. So that is how people came to know in modern world about Kautilya's Arthashastra. Otherwise, it was lost. Only he was a mythical figure. And nothing is known about him. Where was he? Where was he born? Where did he exist? And all that. The rest is all just for TV serials. In TV serials, he comes as an Acharya for Chandragupta and makes him Chandragupta Maurya and makes him the king, and goes to Takshila and does this, that, and the other. Okay? But that is all story. That has nothing to do with history. We have no historical knowledge of this man called Kautilya or Chanakya. This is basically drawn from a play which was called Mudra Rakshasa, which was written in 4th, 5th century AD. And we claim that Chanakya was in 4th century BC. That means 600 to 800 years after he so-called existed, somebody wrote a play. Okay. Bana's Kadambari. And then Mudra Rakshasa. Here we start hearing these stories. Okay. So this is just good for TV serials. But otherwise, all that we have is this text called Arthashastra. But Arthashastra has all these components. He talks about so many things. He talks about statecraft. He talks about, if you want to know about modern economics, we talk about backward area development, how to do it. Oh, North Karnataka is backward. You know, we should give special incentives for industrialization of North Karnataka, we say, right? We talk about Nanjundappa committee report, right? Dr. Jagtap will be able to tell you more about all these types of things which have been going on in Karnataka, right? But Chanakya wrote about it. In Arthashastra, he says that if we want to like populate certain areas, develop certain wild areas, then he says, makes them tax-free. That anybody who goes there and does krishi, okay, establishes their ashrama or houses and then does agriculture there in such deep forests and remote areas, then makes them tax-free, he says. Isn't that the modern policy also? They give you tax concessions to come and build a factory in Dharwad or in Gulbarga or something, right? Which is designated as a backward area. Hyderabad, Karnataka is a backward area. Chalo, let's go there. If you, somebody establishes, he'll be given sales tax exemptions, excise exemptions and so on, right? So that is a policy which Chanakya talks about in Arthashastra. Not only that, today we are being told, okay, that the government should, give money to the poor. Nobody has money, especially the poor, daily wage workers. If the government just distributes money to them, where will that money go? They'll go and buy things from the market. If they buy things from the market, the demand gets generated. So production starts. So economy will revive. So there is no harm in distributing money. So this is one strong advice being given to the government by economists, all kinds of economists, for the last whole year or more. In fact, NAREGA was one form of that. But now they're saying even NAREGA is not enough, just distribute cash. Okay, even America is doing it. In fact, the whole fight that is going on between Democrats and Republicans is right now between two bills, where Trump said we should give $2,000 and the Democrats are saying give $600 and then also do these things. To every person, send a check, they're saying. Okay. To revive the economy, meanwhile, and also to give them some relief. Now, but how do you produce, how do you distribute money? How do you generate money? Of course, government has a printing press. They can print money, right? Government, Reserve Bank can print money. Of course, it will have its consequences later, but you can print money. That's what America does. It prints dollars. And then all of us say, oh, dollar rate is going up, down, and all that. Okay. The governments have that power, sovereign power. And Chanakya talks about it. Chanakya in Arthashastra says, if the treasury is empty, then in the silver coins, the king can introduce copper. He says, what does that mean? You do not have enough silver to make coins, so put some copper in it, he says. That is nothing but what today we call deficit financing or printing notes. Okay. So anyway, so what I'm saying is, Arthashastra is a great example of multidisciplinary product. And he's very, very bold, very open. He says, Brahaspati and his followers say this. I don't agree with it. He says, Manu and his followers say this. I don't agree with it. And I say this. This is the way he starts Arthashastra. So he's a very open intellectual. A critical intellectual, and nobody minded that. So obviously nobody minded that, because you can have differences, you can have different approaches, you can have different prescriptions. So that is just one example of cross-disciplinary things: economics, sociology, law. Everything is involved in Arthashastra: diplomacy, statecraft, political science. Now you look at journalism. I'll give my own experience. I worked in Business India, which was a leading magazine, for 12 years. And till from 92, 93 to 2004, before I joined the Tata Group for next 10 years. And at that time, we had LLMs in our staff. Means not just LLB, LLMs were there. Chartered accountants were there. MBAs were there. I was a physicist. There was a geologist. There was people who knew about the markets, people who knew about economics, PhDs in economics. So it was not just people who knew how to write good English. You cannot produce quality journalism if you just know how to write well. Then you can write a nice novel or a poetry. For journalism, when people are coming, and that too when TV is going on and giving you, you know, hour by hour developments in the business and economy. If somebody has to buy a magazine from you, which comes once in 15 days, and read it, that means you have to give some value, which is more than what TV is telling them instantly, or more than what a newspaper is telling you next day morning. Which means you need more experts who put their all their knowledge together and come out with an analysis which is far more in-depth. Okay. So, if you want quality journalism, you need either, you see, what I'm talking about, that is, it has two ways to achieve it. One is one person knowing many subjects. Okay, that is great because one mind is aware of so many things. Like I was talking about encyclopedias, right? Or in our own history, we had somebody called Sarvajna. Why he was called Sarvajna? He was a radical. He questioned everything. But he had knowledge of so many things. And we don't even know much about him. Where he was born, where he, you know, what was his life and all. We only have his vachanas. Sarvajna vachanas. That too, Chennappa Uthangis and so on, researched it, brought it together, edited it and published it. And he's a great figure. Now we generally say he lived in 16th century in Karnataka. Okay, we don't know much about him. But we called him Sarvajna and he signed his vachanas with the thing Sarvajna because he had knowledge of so many subjects. Okay. So, if one person is encyclopedic in his knowledge, that is great. But everybody cannot be that. Very few people can be that. Very rare examples we have. And we have some examples, I'll talk about some of them, who over a period of time gained knowledge of so many things. So they became walking encyclopedias. You could talk to them, ask them so many things about so many things, and they'll still give you very good information, very good insights into that. Okay, but that comes with wide study and experience and teaching and researching and all that. Because teaching, by the way, is a great way of learning new things. If you have to teach a subject, in fact, one professor in IIT Madras told me, he gave me a book about a subject which was not his original subject. He was working in artificial intelligence. He gave me a book on neural networks. I said, oh, when did you work on neural networks? He said, I have not worked in neural networks. Then I said, then how did you write this book? He said, because I had to teach a course in neural networks. So then I had to, that is the best way to learn a subject is to teach it. Because you have to learn it from first principles. And you should be ready for any question which the student can ask. Which means your fundamentals should be clear. Right? You cannot just say, hey, shut up. Don't talk too much. Sit down. You can't say that. Your conscience says that, okay, even if you don't know the answer, let me go back home and do the homework and come back and tell him. Right? Understand this. So as teachers, over a period of time, you gain knowledge of many, many. By teaching different subjects also, you gain. By different papers within the subject also, you gain knowledge of many things. Okay? So in general, so there is one approach where one person himself is knowledgeable about many subjects. That is great, but that is rare. There is a more practical, another practical approach, which is different people with expertise in different subjects come together and do something. So I gave you the example of journalism, right? Similarly, like if you go to, I was just talking to, my brother-in-law, who is a surgeon, and you know, and in medicine, all the time it happens. You'll have to take the help of pathologists, you have to take the help of radiologists, you have to take the help of, you know, this specialist, that specialist, all together, finally they treat a patient. Right? So This is what is called cross-disciplinary collaboration, which is the topic of my talk, right? So, which is cross-disciplinary means, if one person cannot have knowledge of everything or many things, many people get together to solve a problem. Many people get together to solve a problem. Okay, and this happens all the time in life. I'm not telling anything new to you. In fact, this whole lecture is just, I might have introduced some philosophical terms to you, but otherwise it's all, basically you know it. I'm just like highlighting something. Okay. I mean, you might have heard about quantum mechanics as a big revolution which took place in physics in the 1920s, 30s. The way it happened is because some physicists actually went and were attending some courses in mathematics as just out of interest. And then when a physical problem in physics came, they realized that this problem can be solved with that kind of mathematics. This happened in Göttingen University in Germany. They had a very strong mathematics department. So physics students studying there, bright physics students, who were also interested in some, they went and attended some of these mathematics lectures. And later in their life, when this issue of how to deal with this quantum phenomena came, they realized that these things can be looked at from that mathematical techniques. And that is how quantum mechanics came into being. Totally, only you can say, because these students in physics had the interest and as well as they could had access to go out and sit in math department. So that led to such a great revolution. It may not happen all the time. But what I'm saying is, these are the instances, live instances, where cross-fertilization, knowledge of different fields, or different experts coming together can lead to revolutionary changes in a subject. Same thing happened with we talk about digital and all. This entire digital revolution was initiated by a master student called Claude Shannon. When he was doing his master's, MS in MIT, he connected electronic circuits with logic. Boolean logic was a mathematical thing. Claude Shannon was doing some experimental thing, circuits, okay? He connected the two and he said, I can implement Boolean logic in a switching circuit. And that's what led to digital computing and digital electronics. Okay, and so imagine his master's thesis led to a revolution, his MS thesis. But actually today, most people don't remember him for that. They remember him as a person who founded what is called information theory. That came later. But his actually revolutionary work is creating the digital era by connecting Boolean logic with electronic circuits. Next, please. Same thing is very interesting. I call this sci-tech. That means psychology and technology working together has led to all these new things. Internet is a product of that. It was started, it was led by psychology. Personal computers was a product of that. That development was led by a psychologist. Artificial intelligence was a development of psychologists who got into computer science and collaborated with computer science. Same thing, HDTV. We all use HDTV and high definition TV, or we have all these even in our computers, right? We see movies, we download movies, or we watch on YouTube, what we call MP4 and all MP3 music, MP4 video and all that. All this came out of what is called perception studies. It is interesting that they were led by Indians. HDTV work was led by an Indian called Arun Netravali. In fact, his family comes from Karwar, though he grew up in Mumbai. MP3 came from a group which was led by Jayant, Nikhil Jayant, who is in fact a Kannadiga. Of course, all this work was done in America, but they went from here. Okay, but they used perception studies. It was not just mathematics and electrical engineering. Okay, similarly, Bose speakers, we have all heard about Bose speakers, great music and all. Small speaker will give you the effect of a massive hall, you know, as if you are listening in a concert in a hall. All that came from what is called psychoacoustics, which is a mixture of psychology and acoustics. Okay, next please. So I call this a sci-tech, which is a combination of psychology and technology. Please mute your Okay, so now we have a new development, at least last 20, 30 years. In Karnataka itself, everybody talks about culture studies. That is, it's no longer literature. It's no longer just Halaganada, Vachana Sahitya, Dasa Sahitya, or Adunika Kannada, modern Kannada, and all. Okay, not just poetry, plays, kadambaris, or literature in general. Not just that. Now we talk about combining Shasana, history, political evolution, literary evolution, and all that, and trying to build the evolution of Kannada culture. So I'll just give you, like, Professor Kalburgi. Okay, why he became famous? For which he received great honors and awards, was a series of his books, which were collection of his research articles called Marga. Marga 1, 2, 3, 4, he had published, and then after his death, two more volumes were published of his research articles. Marga 1, Marga 2, Marga 3, 4, 5, 6. They all contain all kinds of papers he wrote, all kind of research articles he wrote on diverse subjects. Okay, from how did the surnames evolve, how did the village names evolve, to Shasanas, to, in fact, his PhD thesis was Kaviraja Marga Kaladalidha Sanskritika Parisara. Means, what was the cultural environment of Kaviraja Marga? Kaviraja Marga, as you might know, many of you might know, was written in around 850 AD. It is one of the first books which has been found written in Kannada. Okay. And interestingly, Kaviraja Marga talks about how to write poetry, what is good poetry, and so on. So, if that was written in 850 AD, then naturally we assume that there was a whole tradition of poetry much before that. But we are not have access to it. So we say first book that we have found in Kannada is Kaviraja Marga. And in fact, he fell in love with it. I mean, so of course, so many people have fallen in love with that Kaviraja Marga. It's a great book. It tells us so many things. It talks not only about literary criticism and poetry and how to write poetry and all that, but it talks about contemporary society, contemporary economics, contemporary politics. So we can choose what you want from it. For example, Mahabharata or Ramayana or Vedas, people have studied them from various angles. Some people have looked at only philosophy, some people have looked at Darshana, some people have looked at it from what are the metals mentioned in Rigveda? What are the materials mentioned in Rigveda? Scientists have written about that. Okay, what are the metallurgical processes written in Rigveda? So you can take if a text is rich enough, similarly Mahabharata. It's not only the stories of Kauravas and Pandavas, but what was statecraft? What were the duties of the Raja? What is Rajadharma? What Bhishma tells in Shanti Parva or Anushasan Parva? You know, how to rule? What does it mean? That means he's talking about contemporary politics. What are the do's and don'ts for a king? Okay, that is called statecraft. That is political science. It's not just morality. Okay, what is good, bad, what is bad, what is dharma, dharma. But it's talking about all these things. So, Professor Kalburgi, M.M. Kalburgi was a good example of culture studies, combining many things to create his works later. Initially, he didn't start like that. He started as an expert in Halaganada Kavya. So, Nruputanga. And he was, of course, as I said, Kaviraja Marga, which at one time people thought was written by the Rashtrakuta king Nrupatunga. But later research showed that probably it was written by Sri Vijaya. Right? And Professor Kalburgi was so much in love with Kaviraja Marga that he named his first son as Sri Vijaya. Okay. Anyway, so similarly, another great historian like that who did number of studies was Professor Shetter, who also passed away about a year back, Shadakshar Shetter. So not only he was a historian, he studied art, he studied temple art, he studied, in fact, he was the leading historian of art and temple art, whether it is Chalukyan temples or Hoysala temples, Vijayanagara temples or Chola temples and so on. So how these things evolved and all that, and what were the artistic trends in that. Okay, he was a leading historian of that. But not only that, he is the only one, not only who wrote about art and architecture and all that, but he also found out and wrote about the artisans who did this. Okay, we all go, we look at Taj Mahal, we look at Belur Halipad, and we say, oh, so beautiful. So either we appreciate its beauty, or we try to find out who built it, when it was built. But we rarely ask the question, who built it? Means, who is the actual artisan who sculpted it? Who is the architect who actually designed this? Who are the artisans? So, a person who did outstanding work in this is Professor Chatter. In fact, as chairman of the ICHR and president of the History Congress, his presidential speech was on the footprints of artisans of ancient India. So he not only read Shasanas, but he wrote about the people who actually sculpted the Shasanas into the stone. We see these Viragallus, Mastikallus, and all that, right? These are called, these are the memorial stones that we find in many villages. A stone saying so and so did this brave act and all that. It is called Viragallu. That so and so Vira died in so and so thing. Okay. So he studied more than 14,500 of these Viragallus and Mastikallus. Mastikallus is about Mahasati. Okay. About a woman who sacrificed, and her sacrifice led to so many things. So it's about her. So about these two, not only studied more than 14,500 of these, and which many other people had also studied in various bits and pieces, but he also found out who wrote many of these things and what was their life story. Okay, so these are all interdisciplinary studies, archaeology, art, art history, architecture, and history, political history, okay, everything combined. And most recent example is what I read this year, rather previous year, 2020, is Manu Devadevan. He's a young scholar. Right now he's assistant professor in IIT Mandi. And his work, this book, A Prehistory of Hinduism, got the Infosys Prize. And you know, Infosys Prize is considered the highest prize in social science and science today. Okay, $100,000, that is 75 lakh rupees is the prize. It is like the Nobel Prize given in India. And his work, A Prehistory of Hinduism, won that prize last year. And I really enjoyed reading it. It is fantastic. He has used, and he is a Malayali, by the way. But just because he grew up in Kannada, in Karnataka, he knows Kannada so well that he has read Halaganada Kavya, he has read Halaganada Shasanas, he has read Halaganada history, he has read modern Kannada, he has written in Kannada, and he has written in Malayalam and English. And this work is a great combination of history, of Shasana, of literature. He has read Ranna, Pampa, he has read every, you know, Harihara, Raghavanka, all their poetry, and he quotes from that. Hundreds of quotations from that to build up his case on how this concept of Hinduism arose, at what time people started talking about Hindu, I am a Hindu, and in what context it started. Okay, very interesting work. Okay, but it is a product, it is a brilliant work, and you know, you might agree with him on some points, you may not agree with him if you have contrary evidence, because again, it is all evidence-based, it's not just. Of course, there will be some opinions, but a lot of it is evidence-based. It gives a lot of things. But main thing, what you see is cross-disciplinary work.
So, still Hinduism is still in debate, no? So, many people, after Britishians came, it got that word.
We'll talk about it later.
Okay.
Next slide, please. Yeah. So, I just want to conclude this. So this combination of specializing, analyzing, studying the part, and studying the whole, studying the relationship between different parts, different subjects, different approaches, both are important. That's why I keep talking about horse and the rider. The rider sees everything, but he can't go there. So he needs a horse to go there. But the horse has to see only one direction in the front. That's all. Whereas the rider can and should see all around. Right? So, gaining knowledge is like that. A teacher has to do both. He is a horse rider. He sees everything. And the shishya, the student, is a horse. He has to be directed. He has to be put blinkers. Okay, blinkered eyes, we say. Sometimes we use it in a derogatory way. Oh, this fellow has blinkered eyes. Means he can't see anything else than what he is talking about. Right? But in the case of a student or in the case of a horse, that is very necessary that the horse is blinkered. Otherwise, horse will look everywhere, but not the direction in which it is supposed to go. Right? So a teacher's job is that of a horse rider. So judiciously, he has to guide the horse to the direction. At the same time, at the end of the day, he has to open the eyes. So you are an eye opener to the students. You are broadening their perspective. You are teaching them particular lesson, but you are also putting that lesson in a context of overall that subject or overall knowledge. And this is what, I mean, the symbol of Prakriti Purusha, that is also very similar. Okay, it's action and theory, action and analysis that is what leads to creativity. Thank you.
Yes, now the floor is open for discussion. Thank you, Shivanand sir. Anyone has questions, please do ask them. Shivraju sir, I guess you are asking.
Yes, madam. ಅದೇ ಸರ್, ನಾನು ಇತ್ತೀಚೆಗೆ ನ್ಯೂಸ್ ಪೇಪರ್ ಅಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲ ಓದ್ತಿದೀವಿ ಹಿಂದೂಯಿಸಮ್ ಯಾವಾಗ ಬಂತು, ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಏನು ಬ್ರಿಟಿಷ್ನವ್ರು ಬಂದಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ವಿ ಗಾಟ್ ದಟ್ ಐಡೆಂಟಿಟಿ, ಬಿಫೋರ್ ದಟ್ ಹಿಂದೂ ಅಂತ ಪದನೇ ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ, ಮತ್ತೆ ತುಂಬಾ ಅದು ತುಂಬಾ ಕಾಂಟ್ರೋವರ್ಷಿಯಲ್ ಆಯ್ತು, ಮತ್ತೆ ಲೆಫ್ಟೀಸ್ ರೈಟೀಸ್ ಅಂತ ಡಿವೈಡ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು, ಮತ್ತೆ ಅದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಪರವಾಗಿ ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ರು, ಕೆಲವರು ಏನು ವಿರೋಧವಾಗಿ ಮಾತಾಡಿದ್ರು. ಅಂದ್ರೆ ವಾಟ್ಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನಿಂಗ್ ಅಂತ, ನಾವ್ ವಿ ಆರ್ ನ್ಯೂ ಜನರೇಷನ್, ವಿ ಡೋಂಟ್ ನೋ ವಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಅಂತ.
ರೈಟ್. See, it is a fact that what we talk about British policy of divide and rule. Okay, so they tried to find differences among people, whether it is based on caste or religious belief or whatever. They tried to find differences. Systematically, they tried to find differences. Just like they tried to find how many species of plants exist in India. The botanical survey of India was done. Geological survey of India was done. Yav yav khanijagalu idave, which minerals are where anta. Okay. The survey of India was done, which is a geographical survey. Which mountain? That's why, in fact, Everest is named after the first surveyor general. Mr. Everest. His name was put to that mountain. Okay. Because he was the first surveyor general. So they listed, they classified, they cataloged everything they found in India, whichever could be useful to them as a resource. So along with that, they found that such a diverse country, if it has to be ruled, then let's understand this diversity, because they were not used to that kind of diversity. No other country in the world has this kind of diversity. Neither biodiversity nor diversity of beliefs, diversity of cultures, diversity of languages, no other country has it. So then they also, politicians among them also saw the use of making use of differences among people. Meaning you identify them, even if they don't identify themselves like that, you identify them as so and so caste or so and so community, so and so tribe. And then so-called encourage one, give more facilities to one and give less facilities to another. 5 years later, you suppress these and give more facilities to the other. So both of the communities will be running behind the British to ask for facilities, for equality in facilities, okay, equality in privileges. So this is the way they used. They divided it up. They did anthropological survey of India. They did caste census of India. In fact, they called codified under when Warren Hastings was there, that what is Hindu law and what is Muslim law. And they published it. It was called Gentoo Code in 1784. And what should be Hindu law and what should be applied among Hindus for settling of disputes was written by this Hallhead, an official, and submitted to Warren Hastings. He submitted it to the East India Company director. And that was implemented as a law, Gentoo Code it was called. And on what basis he came to that conclusion? He called some 20 Bengali Pandits, okay, hardcore conservative orthodox Pandits, and whatever they said is the law, he took it down. So if they said Yajnavalka Sutra says this, Manusmriti says this, so and so says this, then that was made into the law. Whereas even when Manusmriti was written or existed, it doesn't mean everybody accepted it and followed it. It was not the law. It was something, a book written by Manusmriti. It is like you writing a book on what should be the constitution of India. That doesn't make it the constitution of India. Forget about that. Even today we have a constitution. 500 years later, people might discover it. Some archaeologists will discover Indian constitution and say, 500 years ago, Indian people lived like this. Are we living like that? No, it is a book. No. It is a book. It is a book. The book doesn't mean that is the way society exists. You have to do empirical studies to find out how society exists. What practices, what customs, what traditions, how were disputes resolved and all. Okay. So they overrode all that and created this code, a Hindu code and a Muslim code. And then the English law they brought in. And so on. Then they changed the whole judicial system and brought in this English common law, and which traumatized Indians for the next 200 years. Even today, our people don't know how to deal with these vakils and kacharis and courts and judges and all that, because their method of settlement was very different before. Anyway, so this issue of Hinduism, they exacerbated the problem or exacerbated, they created new problems between Hindus and Muslims. But when did people call themselves Hindu is still a matter of study and discussion. While British exacerbated it, for example, we see Krishnadevaraya in one Shasana calls himself Hindu Suratrana, means I am a Sultan of Hindus, because he was comparing himself to the Bahmani Sultan. Okay, they are Sultans. So he calls himself also Sultan, but I am a Sultan among the Hindus, he says. So that is one of the first mention of a word Hindu, by the way. That is 16th century. Similarly, so on. I mean, there are a few mentions like that. But again, you can see the context in which it is used. Not that people call themselves Hindu. He is trying to contrast himself with a Bahmani Sultan. In that context, he says, I am a Hindu Sultan. And called himself a Hindu. And it's interesting that, in fact, in Manu Devadevan's book, he finds in Harihara's Ragale, in one of the Ragales, he finds there's an incident where a Jain girl is courted by a Shaiva, okay, who later becomes a famous Shivasharana and all that, and there's a Ragale written about him. But one incident in which he goes and courts a Jain girl, and he wants to elope with her and get married. I forget the name of that Sharana. Okay. And it is one of the Puratanas. 63 Puratanas, people talk about it. Even in Tamil literature, they talk about it. Okay. Trisashti Puratana. So, in that, the girl says, I cannot get married to you because my parents are Jains and I am a Jain. So, this is the first instance, he says, Devadevan points out, in literary sources, first time when somebody says, because my parents belong to a religion, I belong to that religion. Before that, you do not have mention of somebody being born into a religion. Instead, somebody going to this shrine, that shrine, this Baba, that sadhu, this guru, that guru is different. That means the sannyasis, the gurus, the shrines, the temples were separate. Ordinary people carrying on their commerce and farming and mining and everything, all other professions was different, and you could choose who is your Kuladevata, who is your what Devata, and go and worship. And as well as if you respect some sadhu or baba, you could give him something and donate something, okay, or even owe allegiance to them. Call yourself a Bhakta of so and so. Not I belong to a religion, I am a Jaina, Bodha, Hindu, Muslim. This is a much later identification. And the first literary mention of that seems to be in the 11th century, but we don't know. I mean, problem is, a lot of pre-colonial India, we do not have much of empirical work. How they lived, how they existed, what was the education system, what is the UN economic system. So we have to reconstruct that, because what we have is what British have written, how Indians exist.
British. So sorry to interrupt. We have one more question. So
yeah. So anyway, this is where we need empirical studies, and these empirical studies will have to be cross-disciplinary. Yeah.
Manju sir, please.
Sir, dialect is some explain, Madhi sir.
Okay, see, first of all, the fundamental principle of dialectics is that whatever all the phenomena you see are changing, constantly changing. Okay, so change, recognizing change, motion, development is the first principle of dialectics. So you whenever you describe something, you have to say, at this time, this is what is happening. Not that forever this has been the case. That is a separate issue. First, you recognize that things are changing. Okay. Second, then issue comes, what is leading to that change? On that, there can be number of theories, number of modeling and all. What is leading to that change? But that change is happening is a very important thing. Because a lot of views are very static views. They just take today's one picture and say, this is the way society exists. They don't see what is the motion, what are the currents, undercurrents in that. Okay. And they also don't see history. If this is happening today, what happened 10 years ago? What happened 100 years ago? What it might lead to later? Okay. So, for example, this very question, Hindu. Now, today we say everybody is Hindu or Muslim or Sikh or so on. Okay. So, to even ask a question that when did this start? Will be considered blasphemous by some people. What do you mean from Rigvedic Rishi's time we are Hindus? Okay. So the fact that what you see today is not necessarily what has existed all along, or it has gone through changes, is first important thing to understand. Both in physics, biology, geology, and in sociology.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. I have one thing is ivaga interdisciplinary athwa cross cultural research in bartha ide even for example psychology alle we have cognitive sciences, artificial intelligence and emotion, and in western countries they have many more branches like engineering psychology atharadella. ಬಟ್ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಲಾರ್ಜರ್ ಸ್ಕೇಲ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಆ ತರ ರಿಸರ್ಚ್ ಗಳು ಆಗ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ, ಲೈಕ್ ಆರ್ಟಿಫಿಷಿಯಲ್ ಇಂಟೆಲಿಜೆನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸೈಕಾಲಜಿ ಆನ್ ಎಮೋಷನ್, ವೆರಿ ವಿ ಆರ್ ಸ್ಟಿಲ್ ಫೋಕಸಿಂಗ್ ಆನ್ ಒನ್ ಏರಿಯಾ, ಬೇಸಿಕ್ ಸೈಕಾಲಜಿ ರಿಸರ್ಚ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಡನ್ ಟು ಇಂಪ್ರೂವ್ ದೀಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್?
ಓಕೆ, ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಗಿವ್ ಯು ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಟಿಪ್. ಅವರ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಪ್, ಸೊ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಗಿವ್ ಯು ಒನ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಟಿಪ್ ದಟ್ ಫರ್ಗೆಟ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಆಲ್ ದಟ್, ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಲುಕ್ ಎಟ್ ಸಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಸೈಕಾಲಜಿ ಇಟ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್. Talk about psychology today, we still study Jung and Freud and Adler and at the most Eric Fromm and so on and so forth. Okay. How come we do not look at Indian psychology? Every Indian darshana, Jaina, Bauddha, Vedic, everything, Sankhya, every Vedanta, everything is all about mind, is all about consciousness. How come none of our psychology departments discuss that? We only look at Western psychology as psychology. Why is that? Doesn't that require cross-disciplinary work? That means...
Professor Kiran Kumar from Mysore University, he is into this, and Professor Paranjape also from Canada, they are doing Indian psychology. And they are the inspiration for me to come to this field to do this. But still, it's in a very small, smaller scale happening. So not everyone of us thinking about it.
Correct. Whereas from day number one, we should be thinking about it, not 150 years after the universities came into being. Universities were established in 1857 after suppressing the rebellion. Mumbai, Calcutta and Madras universities were established in 1857-58 after suppressing the rebellion. So almost 200 years later, we are talking about going, looking at Indian systems of knowledge or re-looking at them, because we always believed whatever Westerners told us about ourselves. So if they said, oh, there is nothing called Indian philosophy, it is only religion, it is only like superstition, we believed them. We never looked at what